I want to play by the guest lecturer who is already here. Please, Professor Joshua Oluwole Olowoye. Please, a round of applause for him. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to also invite the Let me also invite Dr. Oludare Agboola of Biological Sciences Department, Federal University of Health Sciences, Otukpo, to the high table. I want to also invite Dr. Chinelo Mokolo to the high table. Please, a round of applause for her. May I also have the honor to invite Dr. Moni Udi to the high table. Now, we are going to commence this program. I want to let all of us know about your presence. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please, at this moment, let's rise for the national anthem and for prayer anthem, please. You don't have? Okay, put the national anthem, please. Thank you. before we close this session. At this moment, I want to quickly invite Professor Chris Onosomede to give us opening prayer.
Let's rise for the opening prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we invite you to our gathering. We thank you for our organs that is took here safely. It's not by his power, by his mind or their might, but by your grace alone. This lecture will come into your hands. We pray for understanding and absorption of what is going to be read today to us. That at the end of the day, your name alone be glorified in Jesus' name.
Please, a round of applause for him and have your seat. I have the similar honor to also invite the professor to the high table, Professor Weibo Anthony, to the high table, please. Prof. I also invite TPL Paul Akoro to the high table, please. So, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, at this moment, I want to quickly invite at this moment, I want to quickly bring, because we are eager to actually listen to this erudite lecturer on this very critical topic this morning. Let me invite the head, Department of Environmental Management and Toxicology, Dr. Godwin Irabo Asibo, for his opening remarks.
Who wants to
link down?
That's your written name again.
Okay. All protocols, I want to appreciate each and every one of us for making time to be here. I won't bore us with much of talk. The Department of Environmental Management and Toxicology is pleased to welcome you all to this first maiden edition of our lecture series, public lecture series. We hope it will continue. And it's just to deepen the understanding of what the department is doing and to also bring a resource person in to challenge us and for the university environment, university generally, and some of our guests to know what we're doing and also to have understanding of the relationship between what happens in the classroom, what we are producing, and our impact on the environment and the community generally. And to this end, we have invited somebody all the way from South Africa to come and give us a speech for us to interact with him. And I believe at the end of the day, we'll all be richly blessed. We'll all be richly enlightened. By the time we are living here, we'll not live here with what we just came with, but we'll live here with something substantial, especially for those of us that are in the research, and those of us that are not even in the research area, you also have something to gain from it. Thank you very much. God bless you all.
Please, a round of applause for him. At this moment, I want to bring in the Vice Chancellor of this university, ably represented by the Deputy Vice Chancellor Administration, Professor Christopher Ajua, to speak on behalf of the Vice Chancellor. The Vice Chancellor, sir.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First and foremost, I want to welcome all of you here and tell you that I am representing the Vice Chancellor, who is honorably, who is unavoidably absent. He just traveled, he has a meeting tomorrow in Abuja. So I'm representing him. The title of, first and foremost, I also like professors from our sister university that are here present, and our guest lecturer came all the way from South Africa to come and visit us to help us in this lecture. The title of the lecture is very, very interesting. It's Exploration or Exploitation, Debating the Futuristic Implications of Crude Oil Exploration Towards Sustainable Development. As you all know that in Nigeria, crude oil is the mainstay of the Nigerian economy. Without crude oil, all of us here will be suffering one way or the other because we are making a lot of money from crude oil. So we would like to hear from our guest lecturer who will be teaching us with this very topic. So once again, I'd like to welcome all of you to this August occasion that is taking place in October. Thank you very much.
A round of applause for the Vice-Chancellor for that brief remark. We have started with brief remarks. I believe that the lecture is going to be a long one. That is why the precautions to it are very brief, so that I will be patient enough to listen to the guest lecturer. And with that, I want to once again appreciate the Vice-Chancellor. Please a round of applause for the Vice-Chancellor. Right away, we are going to call for the citation of the guest lecturer. Because we know we are here to gather enough knowledge on a very critical sector of this country, the crude oil. Please join me to welcome the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Academic Professor Christopher Izenu. With that, we are going to be listening to this guest lecturer, and so I'm going to call on someone who is going to give us citation on the guest lecturer. When I call on Dr. Okologunme to make the presentation.
Vice Chancellor, ably represented by the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Vice Chancellor Administration, Engineer Professor Christopher Mandua, Deputy Vice Chancellor Academics, Dean College of Graduate Studies, our guest lecturer, host teacher, standing on already established protocol, ladies and gentlemen, it's a privilege to be given this task as a technical engineer to read the citation of our guest lecturer. May I only request that our guest lecturer please stand? Citation of Professor Julius Oluwole Oluwoyo. Oluwoyo Joshua Oluwole is a professor of environmental biology. He's an alumnus of the prestigious Obafemi Awolowo University in Ife, Nigeria, where he obtained his first and second degrees in soil science in the year 1995, and a master's degrees in ecology and environmental studies in the year 2001. He completed his PhD degree in biology in 2008 in the area of environmental studies. His research interest is in the biomonitoring of trace metals in the environment using plants, higher and lower plants. And recently is working on some emerging pollutants, namely polyfluorinated chemicals and pharmaceuticals in the environment. In work, His work in PFC in breast milk was among the first set of work to be reported in area in Africa. He recently also published a paper with another high impact factor on the level of trace metals in breast milk. And this is undoubtedly one of the pioneer research done in this field in Africa. I think we should appreciate that. With his research report, Professor Oluwole was able to demonstrate that industrial activities and vehicular emissions are the main source of trace metals in the environment. His research on biomonitoring of trace metals using plants was part of the first set of research conducted in South Africa using plants as biomonitors. He has published over 70 peer-reviewed works, mostly in international journals, and this includes Science of the Total Environment, Atmospheric Environment, amongst others. Recently, in this year, 2021, Professor Oluwole received a recognition from the National Research Foundation, NIRF rating of C2, which further demonstrated the depth of his work as an established researcher. He was appointed a visiting professor at the University of Saskatchewan in 2017 and 2018 in Canada, and in 2020, a visiting professor at American University, Washington, United States. He has supervised to completion 4 PhD students and 15 Masters of Science students. He has received many research grants for his work. He is currently with Sefako Magatta Health Science University, Pretoria, South Africa, and serves as the chairperson of the research committee for the School Faculty of Science and Technology. He serves as a reviewer for many journals and also academic editor for the Journal of Environmental and Public Health. Professor Oluwole Joshua Oluwole is happily married to Dr. Motalani M. Oluwole, and the marriage is blessed with two wonderful ladies and gentlemen. I present to you our distinguished guest lecturer to do justice to why he's here in the forum.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and thanks to you all for coming, all protocols of that. The Vice Chancellor in absentia, the two Vice Chancellors, the HOD is here present, members of the Senate, colleagues from other universities, postgraduate students, friends and well-wishers. All I can say is good afternoon to you all, good morning. I'm not confused. It is good afternoon in my place, and it is good morning here. So I have to say both, because I have some of my colleagues listening to us online. So good afternoon to those colleagues in South Africa, and good morning here in Nigeria. Thank you for having me. And this is it is an interesting thing to be back at home, especially trying to do whatever you can and to assist wherever possible. We're going to be discussing things on exploration or exploitation. Yeah, often, and I have a very good friend and a colleague that we always tell me that you have to come home so that you can contribute your quota. And when I received the invitation, he said I shouldn't come alone, and he's here with me. Ladies and gentlemen, can you please put a round of applause for my friend, Jos Antonio Lewis. I also have, he has decided to, And he cannot leave me alone. He has decided to be with me as well. Ladies and gentlemen, can you also welcome Dr. Dali? And for opportunities for us as scientists, what is it that I can do? What is it that you can do? And for the main fact that I used to come home regularly, I've been able to notice that academics in Nigeria are doing their best. And to this end, looking at the prevailing situation and the condition in the country, I think all the academics in our midst also deserve a round of applause. Without wasting time, I would like to go straight to the presentation. But before we start the presentation, I would like to start by talking about my university so that we can have a good picture of where I'm coming from. And this will also inform us about the discussion that we are going to have today. I am from Sefago Matato Health Sciences University in Pretoria, South Africa. And that is the university that was established mainly for medical students. All we do is all about medical science. And there is a vision for the establishment. And what is our vision? We want to be the benchmark institution that provides holistic health sciences education with the aim of meeting the health needs of individual, the family, the community, and also the population. So when we look at the population, we're talking about Africa in general. In order for us to achieve this, we also have various missions. But for the purpose of this discussion, I've just limited myself to two of those missions. One of these is to provide high-quality primary health care that is healthcare orientated towards research in science, education and services. And the other one is to promote interdisciplinary research, education skills and training that recognizes the cross-disciplinary nature of holistic healthcare production. If you look at the citation that was read, you will see that I started with soil science. Then one will then wonder, what is the link of soil science with healthcare? By the way, there is another form of science, of soil science, that we call geophagia. And there's some medical doctors who call this speaker. And that's the habit of eating soil. There are a group of people that eat soil as we eat cake or biscuits. So we want to understand their feelings. And apart from that, whatever we do in this university, we try to link into the effects that this may have on us as humans. We have just six faculties, and we call them schools. Sorry, five faculties, and we call them schools. We have School of Medicine. We have School of Science and Technology. That is where I belong. We have School of Pharmacy. We have School of Oral Health Sciences. And we have School of Healthcare Sciences. These are just basically all the schools we have. And guess, the student population is just 6,500. For instance, that School of Oral Health Science, we only admit 50 students in a year. Why would they admit 50 students? Because each of these students must be assigned a chair in the department. And that's the chair they use in treating people. So for them to increase the number of admission, they have to increase the number of chair. And each of those chairs costs nothing less than 500,000 rand, which is close to 15 million rand. So that is why it is limited. Same for medicine, they only take like 200 students. Also the School of Pharmacy, only 50 students or more in a year. The idea is to give a very solid education in terms of theory and training for these students. But we have a mission, we have been mandated to increase in terms of the student intake. Because if you look at the structure, you will quite agree with me, it's to be very expensive. And that is why we're trying to improve and we're trying to introduce some new courses. This is just to introduce you to what we do at Sefako Matato Health Sciences University, which is based in Pretoria, South Africa. This morning, we'll be discussing exploration or exploitation. We'll be debating the futuristic implications of crude oil exploration towards sustainable development. That is the current situation that we have. If you look at it, that's the oil dripping from wherever it's coming from. But if not well managed, it may spread doom if we fail to manage it effectively. But if we do it correctly, we will enjoy it. And who are those that are involved in this aspect? We're looking at the government, the oil producing companies, the community, and lastly, those of us seated here this morning, this. And then, how does it affect us? It affects our health, the ecosystem, and also the way we manage it. And this management has to do with those that are involved, either the community, ourselves as members of the community, ourselves as members of the science community. But there's one thing that we need to understand with this, that the reliance on gas for the supply of energy will continue for a very long time. But there are serious attempts to reduce this reliance on oil and gas. Currently, that is what we have. Some even query that the reliance on oil and gas for energy supply is even more than that. But let's just leave it like that, that this is what we have. But this reliance will soon come to an end, very soon. You must have been listening to news on the introduction of electric cars and other sources of energy. And the intention is to see how they can reduce the supply from oil and gas. And then who are these people that are talking about coming together to reduce this effect? And that is China and USA. When these two countries talk, they don't joke. They mean business. So if these two countries are now having meetings, plus other countries, in trying to reduce the whatever we get from oil and gas, I think it is the time for us, even if it is not too late, to see the gas sector happens to be the largest contributors to the country's GDP. And this has generated massive wealth. But one may tend to wonder, massive wealth to what extent? And that is not why we're here this morning. But if you look at what has been written, what has been documented in published papers, it has generated massive wealth. And without any argument, it happens to be the backbone of the Nigerian economy. And in Africa, Nigeria is the largest oil producer and is ranked sixth in the world. But why are we now talking about this? Because this is set to change. It's going to change very soon. And then the plan is to start these changes in 2025. So if this is set to change, we actually benefited from this. What is it that I can do as a scientist to change the tide? And what is it that you can do as a scientist? So that is the basis for the discussion this morning. One tends to wonder whether it is actually exploration or exploitation. And one might also say it is exploration and exploitation. But if you look at the Oxford Dictionary, and when you look at it, it says the act of using someone unfairly for your own advantage. That's the definition of exploitation. And it goes on to say, in some instances, you may say that you try to treat someone in a way that that person is not appreciating the fact that you are treating him that way. We're looking at the locals and the environment in this case. And the intention is that you treat him unfairly with the sole aim of benefiting from him. And it is benefiting from him from their natural resources. And that is the act of using someone unfairly for your own advantage. So the question we tend to ask ourselves is this. Any benefit is great gain to the environment? Because the first thing it does is to provide a pathway for other smaller companies and subsidiaries within the region. And this has also boosted the economy, not only of the region, but also of the country at large. If you look at some of what has been reported in the news, in the paper, and also in journals, the petroleum production and also the exploration of it has created so many job opportunities. One of them would be the employment opportunities, which was one of the very first benefits from the oil industry in Nigeria. And these job opportunities, when we talk about it, ranges from the construction of roads, employment of workers within the industry, construction of bridges, clearing of building sites, and all the rest. These are some of the gains from it. And even the local government has gained from it tremendously, charging some of the fines and all the rest which were imposed on these oil-producing companies. Of course, we also receive educational grants and scholarship. And some universities have even mentioned that they have equipment which were given to them by some of these companies. And also, from the federal government point of view, we have things like foreign exchange, which is the mainstay of the country economy. And if you look at the production history, you'll see there is more production of the gas, more than the oil, and then we have 37 billion barrels of crude oil reserves in 2019, exporting about 2.08 million barrels per day of the crude oil. Not only this, and when we look at it, this is being taken off by India. Those are the markets that we're looking at. And apart from India, we're looking at Spain and Netherlands, and also the United States of America. They are benefiting from this. And then the United States, according to the report which was monitored on their, the overwhelming report that we received from academics, which are supported by incessant strike actions within the Niger Delta zone and even the country at large, shows that the negative impact, it seems to have outweighed the positive impact. Hence, we have problems that we as scientists need to sit down and have a debate around and see what we can do to resolve some of these problems. Because this is what we see in the newspapers. We have pollution of the soil, pollution of the environment. This is supposed to be a farmyard, but what is happening? This is an extent of the pollution within the environment. And then when you listen to the news, this is what we hear from the news. Niger Delta Nation urged not to ask for oil provision. And then Shell tries to dodge responsibility for Nigeria oil spills again. So we're really not going to discuss this effect because these are well known. And look at this, villagers turn to European courts seeking redress for oil spills. Why should they go to an European court when we have courts in the country? Does that mean as academics, we're not doing enough in terms of providing guidance and information on what to do when things like this happen? And of course, these are just some of the things that we listen to us in the news, in the radios and the newspaper, telling us about the effect of this within the environment. So these are well-known facts. And this is the premise for this discussion. If this is what is happening, what is it that I can do as a scientist to assist the community to reduce the effects of this oil spill? We are not going to be discussing the issue of strike actions and all this. No, that is not why we are here today. But we are going to be discussing what is it that they can do to remediate the effects of this oil pollution. And one thing, the first thing that comes to our mind, this is what we have just discussed, is the issue of sustainability. And what we mean by sustainability, we want to have a development that addresses current needs without affecting the capacity of future generations to address their own issue. So this sustainability and the issue of sustainable development, what we want to do is to see a way of striking a balance between global and indigenous efforts to satisfy fundamental human needs without destroying or degrading the natural ecosystem. So what we are trying to do as a scientist is to create a connection between those necessities. Of course, just as we have mentioned, we gain a lot from vision of the needs for the coming generations. So we don't want to finish all that we have now. We also want to think about the unborn generation. And then in trying to do that, we're going to be following the main goal that was set by the United Nations Development Program, which is to be the conservation and at the same time, the judicial use of the natural resources for sustainable development. You remember, when you study ecosystem or ecology, looking at some different types of herbs, must I use it? And if I use it, should I replace it? Or should I leave it without using it? But in this case, we all agree that this is very necessary for our economy. So we're looking at how do we sustain it. And in trying to sustain it, we'll be looking at what we can do as an individual to sustain this. And that comes for management on our part. And that is where we as scientists need to come together. Now looking at the policymakers and scientists. In most cases, this is what we do as scientists. Do you all agree with me? We sit on the fence and we try to avoid making decisions. It is not my business. We do this for several reasons. One, maybe because of promotion, we don't want to criticize the DVC or the Vice Chancellor, or we don't want to criticize the government. So we want to be very careful. So do we continue to sit on the fence, or should we decide to work on what is important? And that is what we need to do. So as scientists, if you look at what was reported by Steele et al. In 2004, said that policymakers from developed countries placed emphasis on the importance of science. Policymakers from developed countries placed important emphasis on the development of science, and their decisions are based on science evidence, both at the regional level, at the national level, and at the international level. And this has come to play when you look at what has happened within the COVID pandemic. Whenever they talk to us, they also say, whatever we are doing is based on scientific evidence. And that is what we want to do. As scientists, we want to see what is it that we can do by not just becoming a passive group or just an onlooker. So we, as scientists, want to base our decision that scientists can and should facilitate their resolution of public environmental decisions by providing objective scientific information to policymakers and the public by becoming more involved in policy arenas. So what is it that scientists also need to do? Scientists should not be seen as a group of individuals who suggest that science is used for less desirable policy purposes, such as rationalizing and legitimizing decisions made by the elite. And elites in our own case will be the politicians. We are not just going to sit down and listen to what is it that they say, rather we're going to sit down and have an objective information and provide information that can be substantiated by science, and that is evidence. So what else do we need to do? So as scientists, we want to give a clear understanding of the basic dimension of environmental problem and what we do. We want to use the known to solve the unknown. So we want to use what is known to unravel the unknown through problem identification. Using the scientists also want to describe and identify options for appropriate solution of the problems that we are currently encountering, maybe from the oil pollution, which might not be considered initially by policy makers. So as a scientist, we have a role to play. So all we are saying is that we can contribute to the resolution of environmental problems by estimating the economic, social, environmental, and political consequences of a proposed solution through time and space and across population group. So it is a call for action, not just a sit-down action, yes. But in an attempt to do it, there are challenges that we are facing as scientists. One of them is that the focus, especially from the VC and DVC, is on output. Do you agree with me? With that publication, can you move to the next stage? It's not possible. And then in some other universities, they use the number of publications. Some universities, we use point systems. But in some advanced universities, you know what they do? They talk about innovation and intellectual property. So we want to be moving from the traditional system, focusing just only on the output, but focusing on the importance and the weight of that output. I'll give you an example. If someone is working on a medicinal plant, and that person is trying to develop a drug, it will take that person more than 4 years to reach that goal. And if care is not taken, if he comes in as a lecturer two or lecturer one, all his colleagues will be senior lecturer or associate professor by the time he finishes that item. But if you go to advanced countries such as the United States, I'll give an example of Harvard University. I was having a discussion with my vice chancellor and Dr. Agola some days ago. He said that from Harvard University, once you have things like IP or your research is innovative enough, you don't wait to move through those ranks. You get what is required. And that is what we are saying, that the traditional system of doing things may need to be relooked, and the focus should not only be on output, but on what you are doing, the impact of the research. So the system encourages individuals, current system that we have in the country, encourages individuals to pursue career paths, which are not necessarily problem solving, but promote personal excellence. So this person is a scientist, he's not solving any problem. But what is he promoting? Personal excellence within specific discipline. I'm sorry to say, in some of these universities, once they become a professor, they said they walk on the corridor. I'm not so sure of that, I'm not in Nigeria. But you can judge. If they walk on the corridors, be careful, some of the professors are here. Otherwise, you will not be promoted. Also, solving the menace of these OSP that are introduced to the country also require collaborative efforts. But when you now have collaborative efforts, the collaborative effort is not going to be just one person or two person on your paper. It requires as many as possible. And the point system in this case might not work for you. But you, as a single author or someone working alone, may not be able to solve the problem. So it requires a collaborative effort. And this collaborative effort may be time consuming. And if it is time consuming, what will happen? It may kill the interest of both the young and seasoned researchers. Another setback that we have within the academic system, especially from developing countries like ours, are the issue that we normally encounter with funders. When you write your application for grants, you will receive it. But the funders do have their own guidelines, and you must work according to the guidelines. And one of the most, one of the bottleneck from what we have witnessed with this funder is that they tell you what to do, when to do, and how to do it. And certain information will tell you not to publish. So those are some of the bottlenecks that we face. While I was discussing this, I know I told you that our friends in Nigeria, then they asked this question, can tech fund help? Do you agree that tech fund has been assisting? The answer is yes or no? The answer is yes. Yes, I agree with you. But I often ask a question, when you say tech fund has been assisting, tech fund will give me 5 million naira to go and study towards my PhD degree in America. While in America, I'll be using a particular machine to do that work. And after the completion of the degree, I'll come back to Nigeria. That machine is not there. Has tech fund really assisted us? So why can't we regionalize this? Have those machines in all the regions. Send some set of people to understand the machine, and then instead of giving me 5 million, that 5 million, immediately I receive it, I need to change my car, I need to finish my house, and the rest, I use it for flight. Otherwise, DVC Research and Academics, when they see me next day, they will ask me, why are you still around? We gave you money to go and study. Go. So those are the issues that we need to discuss. Is it really assisting? If the answer is yes, can we change or can we modify, can we improve the system so that we can have the maximum benefit from it? We need cutting-edge laboratory. For us to submit research that will be funded by these funding organizations, we need cutting-edge research. You cannot be submitting a proposal and using some machines that are obsolete to those funders. They will take you as someone that is not serious. But when you write proposal, you need machines with cutting-edge facts that will assist you to be able to come out with one of these good results. And I'll give you an example. Recently, I published one of my work in one of the high impact factor journals, and what assisted was very simple. It was the machine. There's no big deal about the work, but the machine assisted us. So in essence, what we are saying is that we need good environment. We need an enabling environment to work. And without this enabling environment, we cannot get to where we intend to go. So we're looking at now the issue of sustainability. What do we need to do as scientists, and what is our goal? So from what we have been discussing, you will quite agree with me that oil exploration and production clearly affect the livelihoods, not only of the immediate environment, even of the country at large. And this is commonly seen around production sites near aquatic ecosystem, such as the fresh and marine waters used for ports, pipeline, and storage facilities. And the major problem is the pollution that you can see. This is the major problem that we are currently facing. So the question is this: how do we as scientists assist in resolving this problem? We have identified over the years that there are different forms of pollutants in the environment. We have identified over the years these pollutants. What is it that we are doing to reduce the effect of these pollutants? Now, limiting ourselves to the oil production and some of the pollutants generated therein, we'll be looking at the PAH and then also the trace metals, which are the main type of pollutants from this. When you look at the PAH, these are the most recognized oil components of greatest human health concern because of their persistence in the environment and their potential for toxicity and also their carcinogenic behavior. So as scientists, our major concern will be around the removal of this PAH in the environment using a cost-effective mechanism. Because it has been reported that this could be anthropogenic and they can result in their cancerous cells. What is it that we're doing? And depending on their source of emission, they can be classified into three groups. This below, they could be phytogenic, petrogenic, and pyrogenic. One of the most and the cost-effective method has been the phytoremediation. So with this phytoremediation, which we have used several times, the plants may directly release these pollutants from the atmosphere or produce organic carbon that may be required to bind these pollutants. And when this phytoremediation wants to work, there are some other factors that one needs to consider within the soil environment. You'll be looking at your soil pH, the microbial community, and the nature of the rhizosphere. All these affect the ability of the plants to bioremediate this pH from the polluted environment. And of course, why do we rely on this? This is very cheap and affordable, and in most cases, use indigenous plants. We have other researchers that have used different types of plants all over the world, like I'll be showing you. This is Dactylis durumerata, Fetuca arundinacea, Lolium perenne, Lotus canicatus. In Nigeria, these are some of the plants that have been used. So the question is this: are we having enough of these plants, or do we still think of some other plants that can be used to bioremediate this polluted soil? And that is the work that we should be doing now going forward in terms of the bioremediation of this polluted soil. Looking at other plants, and when we look at other plants, we want to vary the condition of the soil. Maybe we want to vary the type of microorganisms that are present in the soil. We want to check the pH of the soil. We want to do some other things to the soil so as to modify the condition of the soil. Remember, we're talking about cutting-edge research, not simply copying what has been done in advanced countries and repeating it, but trying to modify or having some changes in what has been done. And this is how far we've gone on the issue of phytoremediation. Other method, which is also not expensive, will be the soil washing, which I've not seen so much in Nigeria. But I'm telling you, this method is not expensive. It's just the use of detergent. If you have detergent and some other things that can be used, this method is also very, very effective. And while you are using this method, you can also combine this method of soil washing with phytoremediation. These are costs. This is not so expensive, and this is also cheap, and this is something that we can do in any of our labs. Let's try this method to see how we can bioremediate this polluted soil. And we also have some plants that have been used to remove pH from polluted water. We have plans such as this pragmatic surprise. All these have been used to bioremediate. We also have the microfact, which has also been largely used to bioremediate this from polluted water. Apart from the PAH, we also have heavy metals, which are also a major hazard that we get from the polluted soil. If you look at the production of oil, it has been reported to be a significant contributor to the elevated levels of toxic heavy metals, not just heavy metals, but the one at a toxic level in the environment. I'll be looking at trace metals such as your cadmium, your chromium, your lead, zinc, nickel, vanadium, and zinc. These are natural components of the environment, but they have been present in the environment in a value that is more than enough. If you look at what we have done, if you look at the fourth bullet point, this was one of the work we did in 2020. There are a group of individuals who have a psychiatric problem in one of our hospitals. So what we did was to move closer to them and collect some of their blood samples to see what are the effects. So we found that the level of lead and arsenic were high in their blood. Of course, we cannot actually trace it to vehicle emission or anything, but what we know is that one of the major sources of this in the environment will be the vehicle emission. This is just to show you that these metals, these heavy metals, are very toxic in nature and at the same time can affect us as humans. And what we do as scientists, we want to see a way of removing them within the environment. So we have some of the work that we did with some of my students on how to show that we have these heavy metals in the environment. If you look at the one on the left, it's talking about the relationship between reproductive hormones, your estradiol and progesterone within the obese female. This was done by one of my PhD students, and the effect of this trace metal. And there is a relationship between manganese and lead on the level of estradiol and progesterone. So which calls for further investigation, that there's a link between these. And if you look at this other one, we're looking at the level of trace metals in blood and urine of pregnant women practicing geophagia. Geophagia is known as pica, the act of eating clay soil. So what is the effect? What are they suffering from? So but the intention is not just to look at it, but to look at the effect of this on them. And this was one of the work we did recently on the level of heavy metals in the environment. We're looking at the level of trace metals in the breast milk of mothers who have just given birth to their babies at one of our hospitals in Pretoria. Here we're able to discover that the levels of lead and manganese were very high in their blood. And you see, the problem is not something that you can feel immediately. It takes time. So, but what we do, we want to see that we need to remove this in the environment. So we're looking at various ways in which these toxic trace metals can be bioaccumulated in the environment. So we're looking at the bioaccumulation of these toxic trace metals in the environment, how we can reduce their level in the environment, and then how is it that they enter through the food chain. And then if you look at what has been published in literature, some journals have actually mentioned that these trace metals can be bioaccumulated by plants. You have some plants that can bioaccumulate this metal to the extent that they become toxic even to the plant. And some of these plants is what we eat. You have all these that are present in the environment. So when they are bioaccumulated by these plants, where do they end up? They either end up in your stomach or in my stomach through consumption. And when we consume them, we always feel the adverse effect of these pollutants. So in order to do this, we try to work on how do we remove the levels of these trace metals in the environment. And of course, the removal of these trace metals also looks similar to that of PAH that we have in the environment. So what we did was to introduce different soil medium and also to introduce different soil parameters. We're trying to vary this parameter so as to see how one to reduce to bioaccumulate heavily. So there's a way we want to reduce, there's another one that you want to bioaccumulate heavily all these pollutants. But what we have also noticed while trying to do this work, while trying to remove this face metal from the environment, that different plants have different ability to calculate these trace metals. And you know your plants such as spinach, amaranthus, and some other vegetables have been noted to be hyper accumulators of these heavy metals in the environment. So this is amaranthus, you all know this, we all eat it, but it has been shown that these are hyper accumulators of this trace metal, the same thing with your amaranthus melosus, the same with Artemisia and with Tania sumifera. You see, when we were conducting this study, our intention is not to work on trace metals in the environment. Our intention is to see the active ingredients in these two plants. You see, if you have been following the news, Artemisia afra is one of the plants that were used in Tanzania to fight COVID-19. Similarly with Tania sumifera. But from our whole study, we were using them to treat cancer, and which has worked very well, because they induce apoptosis and they cause necrotic in those cancer cells. But what happened was this. We wanted to increase the production of these two plants. So we decided to collect organic manure. And the organic manure we collected were from cow dung, chicken droppings, and also sewage sludge. Unfortunately, these two plants were hyper-accumulators of toxic trace metal. So in essence, if care is not taken, while you are trying to solve a particular problem, what are you doing? You are introducing another problem. And that's call for action for us as scientists. These are cheaper methods of taking care of someone who is sick. And if this person is living in a polluted environment, so the natural resources that are supposed to be made available for this particular person will not be there. So what is it that we can do to change the ability of this plant from bioaccumulating trace metal from the soil? So we needed to add some other microorganisms that we inhibit the uptake of this trace metal from the soil. This one was completed this year by one of my students, Mr. Raimi. Mr. Raimi, I think we should call him Dr. Raimi now, because he has completed, he has submitted his thesis. He's from Nigeria and he's back at home now. He worked on this medicinal plant, and this is what we have discovered. So this shows that for us as scientists, we still have a lot to do. There is an aspect that is lacking currently in the country, and that is the emerging pollutants. And when you look at this emerging pollutant, we're looking at the perfluorochemicals, the PFC in the environment, which needs to be investigated. But for us to do the investigation at this stage, we need to collaborate with people from other areas, because some of the machines that we are currently using are not all that available. Funny enough, our country doesn't have companies that can produce this PFC in the environment. Similarly with South Africa. Nigeria doesn't have countries that we introduce PFC to the environment. But there's one thing that we are forgetting, that in Africa, we rely on the market of the Western world, importation of goods. I will tell you that we bought some milk, I'm not going to mention the name of the baby formula, in Nigeria, same in South Africa, we detected high level of PFC in these milk samples. So which shows that if we are not producing, or we don't have company that is actually introducing this to the environment, we may indirectly be introducing it to the environment. So far, nothing has been done really in our area to work on this type of pollutants in the environment. And I think it is time for us to start looking at it. So because the sources of this pollutant, which is an emerging pollutant, is still poorly understood, and this may include dust and synthetic material. And we now find them in meat and dairy products. And that's one of the reasons why we're here. We've had a discussion with the HOD of the Department of EMT to see what we can do around this area in detecting. And if we're able to detect, our intention is not to do that, but you know, as scientists, you always want to get a positive result. That's when you are happy. Our intention is to detect, and if we don't detect, we might have wasted money, but I hope we will detect in Nigeria as well. Then we'll be able to see the source, How do we combat, how do we stop the introduction of this? So in South Africa recently, just as I've mentioned, we conducted a study on the, this was done by one of my PhD students, on the determination and assessment of human diet intake of this in retail dairy meat and infant formula from South Africa. And from this study, we're able to see high level of this PFC. So these are part of the things that are done by big companies. But here around us, we also have these companies. Are they using some of the materials that can introduce this to the environment? If they do, what are we doing as scientists to monitor? And what are we doing as scientists to provide adequate information on how to reduce the effect of this in the environment? Similarly with this, we try to change some of the methods that are used to analyze this in the breast meat. And this one was initially done in this was published in 2021. And this one was done in 2018. That was when we were trying to develop the method that we are going to use to analyze those PFC in breast meat. So currently, what we have been able to notice is that there is a dire need for environmental health scientists to conduct a periodical survey involving people living around the oil refineries to see how these pollutants have affected their health. So we're looking at some epidemiological studies. This is important so that we can estimate the current and future health issues that may emanate from inhaling and ingesting some of these toxic compounds from this particular area. Just as mentioned, in one of our studies, we work on people living in the mining area. These are not people working in the mining area, but people living in the mining area. And the target was the women and the children living in the mining area. And the level of these pollutants in them were even higher than those working in the mining area. So the intention, the idea that we are getting from this research is that effort should be geared towards women and children as well, because this affects them as they grow older and older in life. So the environmental health sciences need to have an epidemiological study that will assist them to conduct a periodical survey involving people living around this area. And this study should involve both women and children, and particular attention to the children, with the aim of determining the result of the early life exposure to these toxic pollutants and the association with diseases and disorders in these children. This study should also involve exposure effects, relationship between exposure and disease generation, and also the understanding of the mechanism of toxicity and development of diseases using various methods. And that is what we are calling on colleagues to start thinking about. This is us as environmental scientists. What is it that we are doing? We just don't want to sit in an office. We want to conduct periodical survey. We want to estimate the current and future health issues associated with these pollutants. We want to monitor exposure and disease outbreak. And we want to create an environmental awareness. We want people to know that this is what is happening in our environment and how can they put an end to it. And we want to put particular reference to PFC in the environment. These are emerging pollutants. You will quite agree with me that the current waste management system or the waste treatment plants does not have the ability to remove some of these emerging pollutants and pharmaceuticals. These are present in the environment now. What is it that we as engineers want to do to introduce new methods that can assist in removing this? That is one. Also, what do we want to do as scientists when these waters are released, which are later used either for farming purposes, either for fishing or for irrigation? What is it that we want to do so that these particular pollutants will not be taken up by some of these plants? Over the years, if you look at it, one might also be talking about EIA, that's Environmental Impact Assessment, which needs to be conducted before the introduction of this company. Are they very effective? Are they really working? If they are not working, what are the loopholes? What is it that we can do to talk about the loopholes and see how we can control them so that we can reduce the effects? So if there are loopholes, can we carry out research that will assist us to tighten the loopholes so as to reduce the effect of some of these lapses on us as humans living within that particular area? So we want to evaluate the existing laws, so as to introduce changes where necessary. These are some of the things that we want to do. Of course, this call for collaborative approach. It's not something that I can do alone. It's not something that you can do alone. We want to move out of our shell, talk to colleagues from other universities, talk to colleagues from other institutions, and have a collaborative approach. When I have a student that I'm supervising, am I the sole supervisor, or do I invite colleagues from other departments to join me for supervision? So these are areas for collaboration and opportunities that we can be thinking of. For now, we've been discussing with the HOD of the department, writing a proposal that we want to submit to the National Institute of Health, that is based in America, so that they can help us fund some of our project, exchange of students at postgraduate levels. I want to develop a proposal along the emerging pollutants. And lastly, we are planning also to have an MOU. So oil exploration and exploitation have serious negative effects on the environment. Oil industry, in conjunction with engineers, should focus on developing new technologies that will assist in reducing the risk of pollutants into the environment. Funding opportunities is necessary. As scientists, not engineers, engineers develop new models that will assist to remove this from the wastewater treatment. As scientists, we want to work collaboratively so that we can have new methods and establish cost-effective methods that will assist us to remediate or bioremediate this from the environment. This is my research focus. I have been working on biomonitoring of pollutants in the environment, of course trying to bioremediate it, and currently the focus is on emerging pollutants, impact of it on human health, which we have done, and then we're conducting some epidemiological studies, and also we're working on medicinal plants. The intention of working on medicinal plants is to have an IP so that we will resolve the issues affecting us. And medicinal plants that we're basically working on were those that have been used in treating breast cancer. And I have a reason for working on breast cancer, which I've been doing for years. My mom died of breast cancer some years ago. So it is a challenge for me to see how do I assist the unborn generation, how do I assist people that are coming to start working on issues like this. Currently, I have two postdoctoral researchers in my lab, one visiting researcher, 4 PhD students, 11 master's students. All my work has been fully funded by NRF. Before I finish, I want to thank my university for this wonderful opportunity. The Deputy Vice Chancellor, thank you for inviting me, and Dr. Godwin Atibo, National Research Foundation. I'm working with American University, University of Ghana. I have partners from my Greek Research Council, my brother, my friend that is here, President Antonio Dewey, Dr. Godwin Asimo. By the way, I went to the same secondary school with Dr. Godwin Asimo in 1988. If you see me after the session, I will tell you a brief story of when he was chased out of the class when we were still very young. That was in 1988. And by the way, he used to play football, but I don't think he can play football any longer. And he used to be a very stubborn friend of mine. So he's still very stubborn. And a very good thank you, very, very big thank you to the wife who gave us a special meal yesterday. She gave us a banga. I wanted to say banga. It was banga. I said banga because I used to go to Ghana very well as well. They gave us a very nice banga yesterday. Please thank your wife for me. My junior brother, Dr. Agboola Oludare, who has always been with me wherever I go, because of his chest, he has been able to chase some people away. And my colleague, Dr. Mugibisa, and all the postgraduate students. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
Please, let's have a standing ovation for the guest lecturer for that wonderful presentation. All right, you will have your seat. I said it from the onset that by please can we have more house, please? I said it from the onset that by the brief speeches that we received earlier, that I am sure that the guest lecturer is going to be punching to the point and just take us on a brief exercise. And that has happened. He did that just under 45 minutes. So, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, another round of applause for the guest lecturer. He has opened our eyes to several things under this unique topic today, exploration and or exploitation. It's a debate anchoring on futuristic implications of crude oil exploration towards sustainable development. Well, let me inform you, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, that this event is being live streamed on YouTube by ICT of this university, and we are sure that we are being watched all over the world. Please, a round of applause for our ICT. And you also heard the guest lecturer telling you that he's not only speaking to us here, he's also speaking to his colleagues in South Africa, because they are also watching. Thank you very much for that wonderful presentation. At this moment, the floor is going to be open for few interactions. You may have questions, you may have some issues to clarify. Please, if you have them, begin to send it on to us. While we are waiting for you, I have the singular honor to recognize the presence of Professor Okunye that is here. I also have the honor to recognize the presence of Todd Brook Okoro, the Director of International Development of this university. And I believe that this is one of his responsibility and his areas where he will also be interacting with our guest lecturer on connecting the university to South African universities. Thank you very much, sir, for being here. I also recognize the presence of Professor Akotu, the Director of Academic Planning. Please wave your hands, sir, if you are around here. God bless you, sir, for being there. Now, the floor is open. We want to have robust interaction. Please, I want to be a little bit partial, please. Permit me to do that. I want to welcome the former Provost of the College of Education, Warri, and our own Professor Mary Etema to come to the high table, please. Please, ma'am. Please, ma'am, please. Please, ma'am. And quantification by the guest lecturer. Many of us here who are academics, we have some areas of theorization which he has postulated here. Now the floor is open for you. You can bring in whatever you have written. Is ever ready to respond to those issues.
I also have my colleagues that will be supporting me while trying to provide answers. Professor Antonio Dewey, Dr. Agbola Dada, and also Andrew Eaton, and Prof.
Atul. We also have Professor Obebo, he's a seasoned environmentalist. We have Dr. Elenike, I don't know if he's here. Okay. We have Tipile Paul Aporo, he's an environmentalist who has, he's on the field always, he's here. And I also want to welcome my dean. I think he was here earlier and left. I think he's back now. Professor Edison Enaibi, welcome. Okay. So, Dr. Elenike, you are here now. Please come up. Because the interactive session, they will just, each of the speakers that we mentioned, if they have anything to say within 2 minutes before we start taking questions from the audience. And they can also answer questions from the audience. We take it just about 5 questions. Maximum 5 questions.
All right, please. We'll do it in a very coordinated way. Since we have been directed at 5, we will take from here, number one.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. All protocol duly observed. It's a pleasure to be among you to come and interact. I'm seeing this occasion as an occasion to interact. Just like it was said, there is no Mr. No More. We are in academic environment and everybody should be able to make conclusion. I just want to add one or two things. I'm sure when the speaker, our guest speaker started, the title is Exploration or Exploitation. But along the line, it left that title completely and went into pollution or addressing the problem of pollution in our environment. And I am making this point so that we'll be sure that the speaker is still very much in order. The argument is it exploitation or exploration? Is it a cause? Is it a blessing? And it took his time to explain the benefits of exploration of crude oil. And he started with the problems of that activity. And in addressing that problem, and that was why he delved so much into solutions or how some of those problems will be addressed. I'm making this point so that we'll be clear in our minds that it is not about the speaker leaving that title. It's a debate. It is left for you and me to either conclude if crude oil is a curse, a blessing, is it exploitative or otherwise. But yes, if you look at all those gains, all those advantages, accompany these advantages, accompany these gains, we also have problems. And it's also trying to bring out a way to solve that problem. Nigeria is not the only problem, or it's not the only country where crude oil is being explored. We have places, we have developed countries, the even countries that are, when you are talking of crude oil exploitation or exploration, the Saudi Arabia of this world, even the US, that we think they are important, they are also producers of crude oil. But they will be able to manage all the shortcomings that are associated with the problem of exploration. And that was why he went into details, giving cases, instances of how some of these problems can be addressed. I just feel I need to emphasize that point. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much. I'm really impressed and very, very satisfied at the quality of what was presented by Professor Oluwe. Thank you so much. I also wanted to at least be and also inform him that the maladies that the association is regulating the oil industry are principally governed by the 1969 Petroleum Industry Act has been will be cured, hopefully, if the academics and those of us in the field are able to midwife the proper regulation. The PIA, which you have heard about, has tried to cure those maladies. What happened in Ogoni? You will see that it was difficult in raising $1 billion to clean, even though we recognize what should be done, the funds were not available. I'm happy to tell you that the PIA has a specific provision for funds for remediation, which will be contributed on an environmental audit done as part of the study for the PIA for every oil project. Whether it's exploration, it's production, or it's terminal delivery of crude oil for export, or even for the hydrocarbon processing itself, there's going to be an amount annual that will be paid for that. The issue of those committees is different more important in Italy. But most importantly, too, that regulating the oil industry has become a has always been a political interest. From Petroleum Inspectorate, 1971, we have the Nigerian National Oil Company, which was now transformed to NNPC in 1978 by the decree. You will find that the regulatory body, D, DPR is part and parcel of NNPC. And NNPC is a major player in the oil industry, representing more than 50% in most state cases of all the oil activity going on behalf of government. So how do you regulate those activities with a level of subsidiary? So those policies help to pollute the environment even more. And I'm surprised that the academics are challenging you. Go and look at the law and see how it can be implemented fully. Politicians and voters do not understand all those jargons. For decommissioning and abandonment, there are forms for it as well. We have to calculate for them. Just as we have ICANN registered accountants doing annual audits, doing 3 years audits. Environmentalists also do audits. So that when Shell is running away and they want to disinvest their interest, they should tell them the liability they are carrying in terms of cleanup costs. Let's look at this thing, and I can assure you, if it is well presented, we will get funds for it. Those of us in the field, we see the problem. But without statistics, we cannot justify those funds. Thank you so much. More collaboration with you.
Please, a round of applause for that.
Yes, thank you very much, our guest lecturer. It's quite a topical issue. I looked around at the amount of people here. I don't know whether we have representatives from the oil company and government or agencies. Because this topic is supposed to be one of synergy between the academy, the public, the community. Because what we are advocating today is grassroots community involvement in environmental management. We ask the question whether it is exploitation or exploration. There is both. We started here in the early 1990s. We saw for Capital Development Project called the first EIA.
We good?
Since then till now, it's been a cry of woe. We go to any community. The company, the oil company, has killed and has polluted all the environment. You want to put fish in the tell you no more fish in the water. Even when you catch any fish, they say it's polluted. What I expect at this level with such a company is that we have representatives from the oil company, maybe subsequently representatives from the government. We're talking of EIA. I'll just share it with you. EIA we do in Nigeria is only don't perform freely. Paper. When you are in the field conducting EIA, the development is on. So I think we have to look at that issue. The same way we are in this nation, all over the world, is in a state of sustainability. We cannot do without exploration. We cannot do without development. But we have to be able to mesh this together. So that as we are exploring the environment for our own common good, the people and the environment are not suffering. And EIA was supposed to be one of those tools for sustainable management of the environment. But what we are facing today is a different ballgame. How do we remedy that? After the Petro, look at how foreign agencies execute EIA. When IFC and World Bank funded projects are on, what happens is that by the time you produce the EIA, there's what we call the ESMP, Environmental Social Management Plan. That ESMP, they get somebody they call external auditor, to make sure that after the EIA and the EIS have been given that, somebody is there to monitor the implementation of ESMP, so that as they are developing, you are watching from state to state what is supposed to be done. But in Nigeria, there's nothing like that. Until we go to that level and make EIA real what it should be, we are just joking. We cannot stop the government. Shell has the best thing. They are okay. If you don't worry those days, everywhere is going to be sad of food. Yeah. But they have all that here, they are okay also. And I go ahead, they want to move away from them. How do we solve the problem for the local energy companies that are not managing the oil resources? To make sure that the environment does not suffer. Make sure that the people do not suffer, and also make sure that EIA and what the management are done the way they should be done. What do we do. I think that is something we really need to discuss and send a message down to the other party that is concerned. But I regret that why companies are going to be here. I see my friend here, the NGO Ness. I wish we also have invited one of NGOs, non-governmental organizations, to be here because they are advocates to go out with this message of advocacy. It's a time to let people know what is happening and the way forward. The way forward is where we are now. Not stopping development, we cannot stop it.
Please a round of applause for Prof. We have two more questions and comments that we now have.
My name is Onassis Olori, MSc EMT EPC option. Now my question is, now if you go towards the NPA axis of the expressway in Warri here, you find out that the diesel they use, truckers, about 80% of truckers use is diesel from sabotage, those local producers, so to speak. Now, as environmentalists, we are concerned about how the environment is polluted by the activities of these persons. But you will find out that they are the ones actually sustaining, you know, the diesel supplies. While the NNPC, that's the refineries and the rest of them, are moribund and they are actually idle, though fully staffed. Now, my question is, what is the academic community, the university, so to speak, like us, and doing with respect to, you know, bringing in local production of such, that is making it legal, so that I want to see a situation where an university like this is refining the diesel we produce and all of that. What is the university communities and the academic community doing, especially as environmentalists, to, you know, cushion that effect? Thank you.
Thank you. Can we take one more question before we provide answers?
Thank you very much. Let me start on the existing protocol. First and foremost, I would like to thank the guest speaker for coming to enlighten us on, you know, some of these things you have in the environment in the midst of exploration and exploitation. Well, before I go to my, you know, question, most of the challenges we have here is regulatory. Like here we have federal regulators, states, and even local government regulators. I believe that Nigeria here, we have much more regulators or regulatory bodies compared to any country in the world. We have the Federal Ministry of Environment, the NESREA, NORDREA, National Oil Spill Detection and Response Agency. We also have NEMASA, the Delve into Regulatory Matters. And then the ultimate DPR, Department of Petroleum and Resources, which is currently phased out. We have a new regulatory agency, you know, for the upstream operation currently. In Canada, there's just one regulatory body called Alberta Energy Regulator. And they regulate all the upstream activities, you know, in Alberta province, Saskatchewan, and even British Columbia, the provinces where you have oil. You know, I don't know much about you know, the structure of how governance is in South Africa, but with your experience, you know, in South Africa, I would appeal to you to, you know, educate us a little bit on how these things are being regulated there with a view to helping us to get some knowledge, because right now we have a new regulatory body, but we don't know what they're going to do. But this is the time for people to begin to get ideas from different parts of the world to see how they can be more effective in regulating the activities. Because most of the pollutants you just mentioned in your presentation, they barely have regularized limits and guidelines that will actually, you know, help the scientists in determining whether there are exceedances or not. So I would want you to actually, you know, throw more light on that from the South African perspective.
Thank you. I think I have three questions, and I will read the third one, which seems to be the simplest one. The question is, what is the plan of Nigeria after oil? That's the question, and I think this question is not meant for me, because I'm not Nigerian. I'm not that impressed. This question is meant for...
Please, let be silent, so that we can listen to the response, please.
This question will be very good for, you know, me. He's supposed to provide answer to this question. The person who wants Nigeria. But I'll try to provide an answer on his behalf, if mandated. You know, before oil, we're doing something, and that was farming. And go and check, anywhere in the world, farming will never fail you. There are countries living on it, surviving on it, and they are doing so well. And farmers are very rich. So it is high time for us to start thinking on this. You remember I said from the first slide that things are going to change. And when those two countries have decided to merge, China and USA, they are not joking. And if we depend on them for the sale, and if they say they are not buying a large quantity again, what becomes of our oil? So this is time for us to start having a rethink of what is it that we need to do to change the system. And that is why we're calling on this type of a debate, that we need to sit down and think about what is it that we have done, what is it that we did wrongly, and where do we go from here. And one of the take home from this is that we're looking at remediating our environment, returning them to the normal environment. And after returning them to the normal environment, what is it that we want to do? We want to go back to farming so that we can have something that we can be proud of before we discover the oil. And if you look at what I said, it was discovered in 1959 and towards the early 1960s. Before then, we were living on something, and that was cocoa and some other agricultural products. And I think that is where we may be heading to. After these so-called big countries have decided not to purchase oil again from Nigeria. Going to your question, sir, you mentioned what is it that South Africa is doing. I must tell you that the problem is not so peculiar to Nigeria. It is a worldwide problem. In South Africa, we deal more with mining, and there are illegal miners. And your question goes in line with what he has just said concerning those illegal activities going on. There are illegal miners that are not licensed doing their mining activities as well. We call them Samsung people. But what is it that government is doing is that before you can start anything operation, you need to do all that is required. And he mentioned those things that they needed to do, and that is the EIA. You see, the EIA, if properly conducted and implemented, will solve most of these problems. The guy he's just back talks about the commissioning. So we want to start the EIA where we are supposed to start from. And when you start EIA, there's a particular section of EIA that talks about community participation. And that is why we are involved as individuals. We want to see what we can do as an individual to contribute in our own project. And the EIA also speaks to cleaning of the environment, returning the environment back to its normal status, which we are failing to do. And that is why you see all these things happening. So, and you see in one of the slides, I showed. I will see one of them that if people decide to go to court, that's part of the things we can do. But we need the government to come to our aid. Because as individuals, we might not be able to win the war. It is the war that needs to be won. But we as individuals might not be able to win the war. And that is why it has to be a collaborative effort. However, having said that, when we sit down here and start talking about this, we keep debating it over and over and over again. So what this lecture is all about is that, what is it that I can do as a scientist to solve the dilemmas that we face? And that is looking at bioremediating this polluted site. But bioremediation is not only the option. The option includes action on our part. And the action we're talking about means that we want to implement the AIE the way it's supposed to be implemented, so that we can get whatever we need. You see, before licenses were given to them, there are certain conditions that they need to meet. And they've met these conditions, but when they are now leaving, the commissioning, that's where we supposed to talk. And that's why I talked about the loopholes that we have within the AIEs, which needs to be tightened. And then the loopholes even include community leaders that are supposed to be the spokesperson for people, so that they tell us what is it that it is done, and how are we supposed to do it. And that also speaks to your question. You see, each university has its own vision and mandate. But I must tell you that the problem created by these illegal activities is one of the major problems that we are facing. And these illegal activities keep on going day by day. We will not say because it is legal and people are doing it, we should not legalize it. And because of that, as a university, we should refine it or we should try to do it. However, it is a good idea that a university that is situated around there should have a focus or should have a type of research in that particular area in terms of refining. But this is not something that you can just do overnight. It requires funding. So the university mandate will not deviate from the university mandate. And you remember, the university mandate is training, but providing effective training. So that by the time you finish, you become someone that is capable of standing alone or doing what is required by you. Well, having said that, we are not going to deviate from the department, but this can be factored in as part of research activities in various departments that is supposed to use. And like I've said, this type of research that you have just mentioned, it's not something that one can do, but like this are cutting-edge research that requires innovation and some other things, which is not going to be done overnight. It takes years. So we need to speak to the management, we need to speak to the stakeholders that want to do things, we want to change things from what is done traditionally. Because when you come in as a lecturer, you want to become a professor one day. But when you're back on research activities that takes time, this may affect your promotion as well. So but if you are sure that if you are able to bring about the cutting-edge research, then your promotion is guaranteed. Why can't I venture into it? And that has been the bane of one of the problems in Africa.
The last of this comment is coming from...
Oh, thank you very much, the guest lecturer. Well, it sounds like I'm thinking of something, and I say, we continue to deceive ourselves here if we fail to realize that this is our problem. The exploration of the natural resources, the exploitation at the peak of it, it is our problem. And if we continue to also sit down and think, the likes of the developed nations like US, China, and Co. will come and help us to solve our problem, we are still deceiving ourselves. The solution will not come. And it is high time for us as an individual, each one of us here, to take up a mandate and look at it that, how do we solve this problem? Whether we like it or not, Chevron has come to stay with us, Shell has come, and all these other companies have come. And we are still contributing with our own different activities to the pollution in the environment. Now, we should start to look at it. All our activities is having a footprint on the environment, whether we like it or not. How do we solve the problem? As a scientist, it's high time we stop this attitude of, we just need to publish. Let's start to take our time to time. What is that problem in that environment you are solving? What are your findings? Are we even allowing the policymakers to know the findings of our studies? These are questions we should sit down with. Now, as an environmentalist, let's look at it. Are we doing our bit? It's not just about looking for consulting jobs, but look at it doing it in the right way. If we are not implementing all those policies, we will continue to come back there the next 10 years and we continue to talk about exploration and exploitation. Place within ourselves, we know how to do.
This is just one of the few things that we'll be doing. We still have some programs during the week. We'll be having some writing retreats for some imagine researchers tomorrow, whereby we will be looking at how do we write some of these international journals and how do I get the funding for my research activities. And also we'll be trying to establish some MOUs so that we can see how we can collaborate and work together. Once again, I use this opportunity to thank University for inviting me. Thank you all for listening and God bless you.
Please, a round of applause for the guest lecturer for their wonderful submission. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, at this moment, the Vice Chancellor, sir, the Deputy Vice Chancellor Academics, I want to invite the head Department of Environmental Management and Toxicology for his vote of thanks.
Vice Chancellor, sir, the DVCs, academics, and admin, and all our invited guests, we appreciate you all. Before I give the vote of thanks, I want to inform us that the guest lecturer is still around. Tomorrow we have interactive sessions with the postgraduate students by 11 a.m. The venue will be sent to us on our platform. Then by 2 p.m., you'll also be having interactive session with selected academicians. That will be by 2 p.m. For those that are interested, please, we'll be using the, we'll be using the College of Science boardroom for that. That's for the 2 p.m. interactive sessions. But for the postgraduates, it will be sent to you on your platform. But it will be by noon 8 p.m. spent to ensure that we have a successful program. For the postgraduate students, I appreciate you all. I call on you and you answered me. I pray that for coming here to do your postgraduate program, you'll get your certificate in time. I thank all the guests for being an outside university for honoring our invitation and producing this occasion. Once again, I say thank you all. God bless you all.
Here is a round of applause for him. At this time, I call on Dr. Elias Elimike to give us closing prayer.
Shall we rise for the closing prayer? We pray in the name of the Father and of the Son. Eternal Rock of Ages, we thank you for an opportunity like this to gather. We thank you for the guest lecturer that you brought to us. Safe and sound. We appreciate you for the knowledge we've received through him. Father, we thank you. We pray for wisdom. Enable us with the wisdom so that everything he has taught us, we will be able to internalize for the progress of this country. While he will be going back, we pray for Johnny Menzies and for all of us here, while we will be going back to our offices. We pray you will be with us. Continue to assist us, the Vice Chancellor, the Deputy Vice Chancellors, the Directors, Academic staff, and non-academic staff of the universities. We pray for your continuous wisdom, knowledge, so that together we will be able to move this university forward. All this and many more, we pray in Jesus' name.
Please. Immediately after the national anthem, please wait.